access the supernatural directly, the spiritual directly. It is always mediated to us. So what this means is that the natural matter is good. I want to say that again. The natural matter is good. Listen to what Genesis 1:31 says. God saw everything that he had made, and it was just so-so. Oh, I'm sorry. That's not what it says. What does it say? God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was not just good, but very good. He's beholding all of creation. He's beholding the natural order. He's beholding matter. And it was very, very good. I think that for some of us, unfortunately, our impression of creation is that if we really get involved in creation, it will lead us away from God. But what's the real truth? If we really get involved with creation as God created it, where should it lead us? To God. Do you see how sometimes we have a misimpression? That we think the best way to be holy is to withdraw from the world? Is to isolate ourselves? And truly the best way to be holy is to get ourselves back into the world, into the Creator, into matter as God designed it to be. What did the Synod say? We need to bridge the gap between church and daily life, between doctrine and daily life. But creation by itself is not the whole story. This is the problem with atheistic evolution. Is it says creation, the material, that's the whole story. And so if we adopt that mentality, we're in trouble because we only have half the story. And the truth is that matter, the natural, is open to communicating God. This is what's amazing, is that creation can communicate that which is beyond itself. It can create the spiritual. It can communicate the supernatural. So here's another way of saying this. Nature, in other words, the material, reaches its perfection only in relationship with the supernatural. Creation reaches its perfection only in relationship to the supernatural. So if you watch The Bachelorette, is that the conclusion you're going to come to? Oh, it's obvious that the natural only reaches its conclusion, its perfection in the supernatural. No, this is why we have a mission. We have to share the good news so that other people can be transformed by it. So let's take a simple example of how the natural comes to its perfection in the supernatural, bread. So when does the wheat and the bread reach its perfection? What was wheat and bread created for besides to nourish us? That's the natural dimension. What's the supernatural dimension? The Eucharist. Do you see the natural matter of bread and wheat only reach their perfection in the supernatural reality of the Eucharist? That's why wheat and bread were created. Unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground and dies and sprouts and is harvested and crushed and made into bread and becomes the body of Christ, unless all that happens, it remains what? Just a grain of wheat. It remains just natural. It remains alone. Profound. That's what John 12:24 says. Unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it remains alone. If we stay just at the natural level, we will never understand fully the meaning of creation and the meaning of ourselves. So this means that matter, the creation, the natural, is always open to the more. Always open to the more. And this leads to FOP number 3. Matter mediates mystery. Foundational principle number 3, matter mediates mystery. So what mystery does matter have the capacity to mediate? Grace. God's divine life. The mystery of God. Matter mediates the mystery of God. The bread, the wheat, mediates the mystery of God, of God's divine life, of God being able to communicate himself to us through matter, through the natural. So tell me, what do we call something that's a visible expression of an invisible reality that communicates grace? A sacrament. So this is why I said that John Paul II's anthropology is not just a robust Trinitarian anthropology, but did you hear that other word? A robust Trinitarian sacramental anthropology. Because it's all about how matter, how the natural, how the created order, how the body communicates God, communicates something beyond itself, right? You're going to get poked a whole lot. Right? That when she touched him, it communicated something beyond itself. She touched his heart. She touched his person. She didn't just touch his body. She touched his person. Profound image of foundational principle number 3, that matter mediates mystery, that matter has the capacity to mediate more, to communicate God. And that brings us back to foundational principle number 1, that where we started, that the body is not only biological. In other words, it's not only matter, but it's also theological. It communicates more than just its biological systems and processes. So I was thinking of all of you when I was writing this, because we've got a whole wonderful group here who work for a local OBGYN. And so all the time, you are dealing directly with the body. And so you have an opportunity constantly to remind yourself, this body is not just a body. This body mediates, communicates God. I mean, we hear this, treat each person as if he or she were Jesus. What does that mean? It means that this body mediates or reveals God to us. So in Audience 9, here's what John Paul II says. The body is not only anthropological, but also essentially theological. The theology of the body, which is linked from the beginning with the creation of man in the image of God, becomes in some ways also a theology of sex. Now pay attention very closely. Becomes in some way also a theology of sex. Now notice what he says next. Or rather, a theology of masculinity and femininity, which has its point of departure in Genesis. Most often when John Paul II uses the word sex in theology of the body, he's using it in its original meaning, which is male-female, masculinity and femininity. So someone comes up to you and says, well, is theology of the body a theology of sex? What do you say? Absolutely. But it depends on what you mean by sex. It's a theology of masculinity and femininity. Do you see why we need to know the author's intention? We need to be reading John Paul II's words himself in order to be able to get inside of his mind and what's he communicating? So this leads to foundational principle number 4, which is a bit of a mouthful. But I trust that by the end of the workshop, you will be singing this one in your sleep. Here it is. Ontology precedes morality. Ontology, O-N-T-O-L-O-G-Y, precedes morality. Now, some of you are like, really, Katrina? Come on, we're not in a philosophy class. I know you're not, and I also know that it's Friday night, which is why you have your workbook in front of you, so that most of it's provided for you. But I also know that if we don't understand these foundational principles, guess what can happen when we read Theology of the Body? We can be taken off a direction that John Paul II didn't intend for us to go. So ontology precedes morality. What does that mean? Actually, it's really simple if we do that bridge between church doctrine and daily life, everyday language. It simply means that before we can know how we should act, because that's what morality is. Morality is how you should act. You should do this and not do that. That's what morality is. So before we can know how we should act, we have to know who we are. That's it. It's really simple. So ontology means, who are we? Ontology means the study of being. Who are we as human persons in our being, in our nature, in our makeup? We have to know who we are as human persons before we can know how we should act. This is really going to be a very important principle for John Paul II. So in your experience of listening to people teach about church doctrine, is this normally the way church doctrine is presented? That first of all, someone talks about who the human person is and about human identity, and then they talk about church's morality? You're all shaking your heads. What usually happens? This is what the church teaches. This is how you should act, period. Guess what? That's not the way John Paul II teaches. Look at over here. Guess what this is? This is our robust Trinitarian anthropology. Guess when we get to talking about morality? Here. That's a long time. John Paul II spends a long time talking about human identity before he ever gets to talking about how we should act. So I think that we have a little bit something that we can learn from John Paul II. I myself am still trying to learn because I love concepts. I love abstract. I'm trying to learn how to be much more concrete. I'm not doing such a very good job at this opening section because it's all very abstract in the foundational principles. But it's so that then we can be concrete. So when we say ontology precedes morality, just remember is that before we can declare how a human person should act, we have to know what a human person is. That's the distinction. Before we can say what we should do, we have to know who we are. So the two questions that we want to keep in mind in terms of understanding who we are is, who am I and why was I created? Those are the questions of identity. Who am I and why was I created? And that's what we're going to see. That's John Paul II's project in his triptych. He wants to answer, who am I as a human person and why was I created? Would you say that teenagers sometimes ask this question? How about college students? How about women in their 40s? How about a man who's just lost his job? How about a woman who's been married for 8 years and can't conceive a child because she's struggling with infertility? Do you see all the ways this question, who am I, comes back, comes up over and over and over again? Who am I and why was I created? Two most important ontological questions to answer who we are as human beings. Okay, great. Let's see. Wonderful, covered all that. Okay, great. So that means I think we're up to just reviewing the four foundational principles, correct? Okay, would you read those out loud for me? The body. Oh, come on. Let's hear it all together. The body? Wonderful. Foundational principle number two. Foundational principle number three. And foundational principle number four? Wonderful. You all passed. You get an A. Wonderful. All right. Great. So now that we've got some of the foundational principles, we've got a scaffolding onto which we can hang some things. Let's turn to theology of the body. Before we do that, I want to give you a 2-minute stretch break. Okay? So you put your pens down, stand up, maybe do, you know, dance salsa for 30 seconds. Get something to drink if you want. So the overview of theology of the body, two halves, and if you'll change that to 5 panels. So the human person, what's the blank? Before original sin, the human person after original sin, and the human person in eternity, exactly. And then under sacrament, if you'll make that panel 4A, which is sacramentality of marriage with a small s. And then panel 4B is sacrament, so instead of panel 5, make it 4B, sacramentality of marriage with a large s. And then make it panel 5. It's not enough to define the human person solely according to what is material or physical. Great. See, this is a good way to review, isn't it? I love it. Okay, we must take into account what is invisible. The spiritual, the supernatural. Ha ha. Tricky one, huh? Okay, and that last blank begins with a capital G. God. God. Okay, so foundational principle number 2, grace perfects nature. So St. Thomas Aquinas, grace does not destroy nature, but perfects it. Wonderful. Grace doesn't get rid or discard nature as if the body and human nature become irrelevant because only the soul or the spiritual matters, either one of those. And then I know I said this one. We can't have the supernatural without the natural. Wonderful. Okay? So in the created order in this world, the supernatural and spiritual can only be expressed through the natural, through the material or physical. Number 6, creation by itself is not the whole story. The natural matter is also open, so turn the page. Oh, did I miss one? Oh, I'm sorry, and is also open to something more. Yeah, sorry. So whenever there's an M with a blank, most of the time it's going to be more. The natural matter is also open to communicating something more. The supernatural, the spiritual, God. So nature, the material, reaches its perfection only in relationship to the supernatural. Great. And then I forgot this one, which I didn't. I wanted to make sure that I said this, and I didn't. Matter matters because matter is always open to the more. How's that for a mouthful? Matter matters because matter is always open to the more. It's a great, really, I mean, like, write in a 3x5 card and put it over your sink. Matter matters. But why? Because it's always open to the more. It's always open to communicating something beyond itself. Okay, and we got foundational principle number 3. Matter mediates mystery, the mystery of God, which equals a sacrament. Wonderful. So matter has the capacity to communicate more than just itself. It has the capacity to communicate God and grace. Exactly. Wonderful. And then foundational principle. Sorry. I notice here under number 3, the question. So the question that John Paul II is addressing is why male and female? So theology of the body, even though we call it theology of the body, the formal title is man and woman, he created them. Because the question that he really wants to address, why male and female? In other words, why do we have an embodied masculine and feminine nature and not a purely spiritual nature? Have you ever asked yourself that? Like, why do we have a body? Why aren't we angels? Why do we have an embodied nature? Why don't we have just a spiritual nature? I think it's one of those questions that a lot of times we don't exactly put words on, and yet it does kind of flit across our minds every once in a while, especially when we say, ugh, why do I have this body? Or I wish I had a different body, you know? Or why can't I be more like the angels? It must be so easy to be an angel. Right? Those are all expressions of why? God, why did you make us with an embodied nature? And with an embodied nature, that means why male and female? So it's really the task that we are undertaking. And then before we can declare how a human person should act, we have to know who the human person is. Wonderful. So ontology precedes morality. And then that we have to always address human identity. Who am I? Why was I created? And then connect those with church teaching and scripture. So it's not enough just to say, you know, who am I? Why was I created? How many of you have had friends who sometimes have made choices that you might kind of question, And when you ask why, they say, oh, because I had to find myself. Okay, it's important to find ourselves. But finding ourselves always needs to be rooted in Scripture and church teaching. We can't just kind of go out and find ourselves with no boundaries. So theology of the body is really a work on human identity. And we must avoid reducing theology of the body to a sexual morality. Sexual morality is important. It's part of it. To a sexual matter, is that what you said? Or sexual more?
Manual.
This is true. We need to avoid reducing theology of the body to a sexual manual. Thank you very much. That's a good way of putting it. Again, is that part of it? Yes. But we have to be patient to get there. Because then everything falls in place. Because then, you know what? We're not arguing sexual morality. Do you notice how the church has to argue sexual morality? Instead, if ontology precedes morality, all we have to do is invite and illuminate light of faith. We just say, well, if this is the way you're created, well, then this makes sense. Have you ever thought of it that way? See, it's a very different way of presenting church teaching. Okay, great. Thank you so much. And please feel free, if I have jumped around like that, to say, wait, Katrina, you skipped a whole section. Please help us. So it's good because this keeps me on task as well as you. All right, wonderful. So let's jump into then theology of the body itself. So we're in the first half, and what's the title, please, of the first half? The Words of Christ. The Words of Christ. Which means that in every single one of those panels, so we've got three panels, John Paul II is going to begin with the words of Christ. He's going to begin with the gospel. Why? Because the first encyclical of John Paul II, entitled The Redeemer of Man, begins like this. The Redeemer of man, Jesus Christ, is the center of the universe and of history. Jesus Christ is the center of the universe and of history. And so as a result, John Paul II begins every single one of those panels where we're talking about who the human person is, we're talking about ontology, our being, he begins with Christ. So that statement that Jesus Christ is the center of the universe and of history is not simply a nice poetic sentiment. It is the backbone of reality. So Joe, could I borrow you for a moment? Would you be so kind as to come up here? I promise I won't throw you in the air and take a picture of you. Okay. If I were to take my handy dandy wand, don't worry, I'm not going to touch you. And I were to wave this over you and remove your backbone, yeah, what would happen?
It would collapse.
That's exactly right. You would fall into a heap on the ground of a pile of bones. Why?
Backbone is what holds me up.
That's it. Your backbone is your supporting structure. Now, that wasn't too painful, was it? Okay, great. Have a seat. That's it. Why do I say that? Think of Jesus Christ as the backbone of reality. If we remove Jesus Christ, what happens to reality? It collapses into a heap of disconnected bits. Think of that. A pile of disconnected bits, just like Joe would be if I took out his backbone. This is what we're talking about. This is what's at stake. In terms of the gospel, the good news. The good news is that Jesus Christ is the backbone of reality. Or in John Paul II's word, he's the center of the universe and of history. And so we see this in John Paul II's very way of doing theology. He is an outstanding catechist because he begins with Christ. And then everything takes its meaning, its light, its understanding from Christ. It's Jesus Christ who illuminates who the human person is and what creation is. And that leads to FOP number 5, foundational principle number 5, which is a quote from Gaudium et Spes 22. Jesus Christ fully reveals man to himself and makes his supreme calling clear. It's just a nice way of saying Jesus Christ is the backbone of reality. Did I lose you in the workbook? Okay, great. So GS24, what does GS mean? It means Gaudium et Spes, which is one of the Vatican II documents. We're going to come back around and bump into Gaudium et Spes again, and it'll be in your workbook, and it'll be written out. So don't worry, it's there. We'll get to it. So GS22. Jesus Christ is the center of the universe and of history. That means if we want to know who the human person is, because that's our project, why male and female? Why embodied human nature? If we want to know who the human person is, who do we have to know? What do we have to know first? Who Jesus Christ is. So Jungle 2 begins in Matthew 19 with Christ's words on divorce. Now, I don't know about you, but if I was going to start 133 Wednesday audiences, which is what Theology of the Body is, so this book is a collection of 133 Wednesday audiences that Pope John Paul II gave in Rome from September 1979 to November 1984 in two halves and five panels to talk about the human person made male and female. Would you start with divorce? That's kind of an odd place to start. And yet, John Paul II understands that marriage and the marital relationship is perhaps the most significant human relationship. And here's what we need to underscore. And if we don't understand marriage and its indissolubility, what's one of the issues for the synod in Rome right now? The indissolubility of marriage. Look, John Paul II nailed it in 1979. If we don't understand marriage and its indissolubility, then, and look at this list, we won't be able to understand the human person, we won't be able to understand our destiny, and we won't even be able to understand God. Do you see what's at stake with marriage? In a way, the whole understanding of the universe is at stake with marriage. If you change marriage, you change the understanding of the universe. You change the understanding of creation. That's what's at stake. Because matter mediates mystery. And that means marriage and the marital relationship composed of matter is going to mediate something about God. And so you begin to tinker with marriage. You begin to change the whole structure and understanding of the universe and of who God is. This is why we need a robust Trinitarian sacramental anthropology, not just some wimpy understanding of the human person. Okay, so I think you know the story. The Pharisees come to Jesus, and they want to know, is it lawful to give their wives a writ of divorce? Can they divorce their wives? And Jesus replies, it was for your hardness of heart that Moses allowed divorce, but from the beginning it was not so. So it's this beginning that John Paul II wants to analyze in order to understand God's original design and intention for the human person, for the body, for marriage, and all creation. You might want to circle those four things. He wants to go back to the beginning to understand God's original design for the human person, for the body, marriage, and all creation. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to be, John Paul II begins with the words of Christ, but then he goes back to Genesis 1 and 2. So have you ever noticed, and I think some of you have by what you said earlier, that John Paul II doesn't write like a normal person? Anyone ever notice that? That's what drives us all crazy. First of all, though, it's because he writes like this. He writes in a spiral, not in a linear manner. Now, in the West, and remember, John Paul II's not from Western Europe. He's from Central Europe. That means his culture is a bit different. But in the West, we're used to not this. We're used to a linear way of writing. Something has a beginning, a middle, and an end that we move through in a very logical and sequential manner. But what I like to say, but not the spiral pope. It's not the way he writes. He writes about something, And then he'll go away from it for a little while and develop some other ideas. And then he'll make a turn on the spiral and he'll come back to that original theme, only he won't just say what he said before, he will deepen it. And then he'll continue on the turn of the spiral. This is why the foundational principles are important, because they undergird this spiral style that we're going to keep coming back to and developing these foundational principles, but with flesh on them as he develops his themes as we go across. So I always want to encourage people to not expect John Paul II to be writing in an efficient manner. That's us in the West. We want to write efficiently, not John Paul II. John Paul II's goal is not to get from point A to point B in the quickest way possible. It's not his goal. That's our mindset, efficiency. Instead of efficiency, think of theology of the body like having dinner with a friend that you haven't seen in 20 years. If you have dinner with a friend that you haven't seen in 20 years, are you going to get through all the material in the first 15 minutes and catch up on 20 years in 15 minutes? No, what are you going to do? You're going to enjoy probably a couple hours of dinner as you go through and disclose and talk about everything that's gone on. See, you're going to spiral around. And if you're a woman, you're going to be going off here and up there and down, right? Because that's what we do. So likewise, in John Paul II's writings,